To Genesis Video 4. We're doing the drivetrain in this. We've only got the drivetrain left to do, and then the final of the hatch. We're just gonna smear some silicone around it, and that's about it. So here we go. We're going to do the prop first. We're going to sharpen and balance the prop. Now, this is the one we're gonna be, oops, shift the bed. The one that we're gonna be using is a 3/16 shaft beryllium copper. Now, beryllium is a very, very, very nasty, it's Noctura 440, by the way. Beryllium is a horribly carcinogenic, nasty-ass material in its dust form when it gets into the respiratory system. I've been to beryllium foundries, and trust me when I say it's not the best found you'll ever have. So, what we're going to do, a lot of people, how they sharpen and balance these. We're not going to worry about balance just yet. We're going to detongue a little bit, and which is taking the edges off of here and here. And we have to sharpen these edges. A lot of people, what they'll do is they'll grind and buff these things. I'm not a professional racer, but I still want it sharp. You want your prop sharp because what happens is when you're spinning at that high RPM, remember, we've got a 2075 KV motor in there. It's going to be running 6S, so that's 2075 per volt. That's a lot of speed. So when you're not cutting clean, it's just like a quad, not only will you get vibration from being out of balance, and that's what we always worry about with quads and planes, right? When you're out of balance, you get excessive vibration, shit rattles apart, and that's bad. That's bad for a boat too. But you want to be sharp because you are cutting through a mass. And if you don't cut sharp, you actually think of it almost like as a friction. When you get friction, you get what's called cavitation. What cavitation is the boiling effect of water, believe it or not. You can aerate, and aerate is sucking air down into the prop blades, which causes more cavitation. But actual cavitation will happen even on a submarine. That's why submarine propellers look so funky. They might have like 20 fucking blades to them and they're all crazy. And that is to limit the spin in the water to reduce cavitation. What cavitation does, this is the front of our prop. This is the back of our prop and we're screwing left-handed, right? Like this. So what happens is you're creating a high pressure environment, a low pressure environment, just like a wing, if you will, okay? So what happens with that is with the speed and the pressure dissipation, you're actually boiling the water, believe it or not. So when you boil the water on a real propeller on a boat, and maybe you can see it on a model, I'm not sure, you can actually burn the prop and get marks. It's really crazy. So to eliminate our cavitation, that's what we want to do. We want to have a nice, nice sharp edge. Now, a lot of guys, what they'll do is they will sand or grind these things with oil and they wear a respirator and they do all this stuff. I'm actually gonna grind mine underwater. I am gonna use gloves, not really necessary, but better safe than sorry. Like I said, it's nasty stuff. So we're not gonna worry about balancing because it's stupid to balance a prop first and then sharpen it and take mass off because obviously it's gonna become out of balance again, so we're gonna balance last. I use soapy water because believe it or not, the soap acts as a lubricant. So when you're sharpening a blade, the only side you wanna sharpen is the tongue side, okay? So which is the side facing the boat, okay? This is the power side, this is the relief side. You only wanna work with these edges, okay? So I'm gonna take a Dremel with a sanding disc, okay? Now, the nice thing about this is I'm using the Dremel extension so I can't get electrocuted. That comes in handy. So we're gonna go ahead and do this. Now, if you've never done this before, it's kind of a bitch to do underwater. Okay. Cavitation. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. It's kind of hard to do on camera, obviously, but that's what we're getting. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and do this off camera, and then we will come back and we will balance. So I will be right back. All right, we're back. So I did the preliminary sharpen and I also polished it, okay? It is rather sharp. Could go a little bit better, but I think it's gonna be good enough. I polish it with doing the same method underwater with a wire wheel on the Dremel. And that way it just gets this nice polished glow to it. Very cool. So the next thing we're gonna do, I still have my water behind me, okay? Now we're going to take a prop balancer. Now those of you that are into RC planes or larger photography quads, things like that, you probably already know what a balancer is. This is a magnetic balancer, so it is nice and resistance free, and you can use it for a prop. Too close. Boat prop, I mean. A lot of guys use smaller ones. This is like for up to a 12-inch prop, I think. Come on, bitch. You don't want both ends touching. See that? It's perfect, okay? Yeah, it's not perfect. That's perfect, okay. So now what we're gonna do, pay attention to your tongue right there, all right? We're gonna have that always facing to the right. Doesn't matter, but that's just for reference later. We slide it through the shaft. Bam, just like that. Then, way out of balance, okay? I'm gonna let this, stop spinning on its own, which isn't going to take long since it's bounced like shit. Woo, buddy. Look at that. So this lobe right down here is really heavy. See that? Really heavy. So what we're going to do on the front side, because remember, we do not grind or anything on the front, only on this side. So what we're going to do now, where's my marker? We're gonna mark this so we know it's the heavy side. Okay? I'll use a wire wheel later to get that off. All right. Now, again, like I did before, I'm gonna do this in the water so none of the dust comes up. You don't have to do it that way. You can smear it in oil and wear a respirator and do just as well. So we're gonna go ahead and take some of that off. And how I take this off, usually, because this is a lobe weight issue, it's not a hub issue. A hub issue is when it will balance this way, laterally, you know, horizontally. You put it up and it falls back like this. That's a hub issue, meaning this side of the hub is heavier than this side of the hub. This is a blade issue because it's always favoring the bottom, the marked blade. So how I do this is I will just continue to sharpen this side until she's nice and sharp. Then we'll just keep checking, keep checking, keep checking. So I'll go ahead and do that. Be right back. All right, so we're getting warmer. This sucker's really out of whack. So remember when I first put it on there and I would spin it, it slowed down really, really fast because it was so lopsided that it just, too much vibration slowed it down. So now let's see what we got. A lot better. All right, and you can see now it's tending to favor the center, so we know it's a topside hub. So what we're going to do, and it still needs a touch of balance on that blade, but that's okay. Now I can at least do both at the same time. And if you can see, which you probably can't, there's actually a casting seam right here. So that's probably what's throwing us. Well, no, the bottom side's heavier. So this is the light side where the mark is. I'm doing that for camera purposes. See what she does. Yep. Okay. So I think we can pretty much just go ahead, take a little bit off of the bottom of that hub. Notice how it is always going to favor that dot shining up, facing up, not shining. And that is hub balance. Because it's still going laterally, It's not being heavy on the lobe now or on the blade, it's heavy on the hub. So same thing as a quad. If you have this problem with, if you're doing, we usually don't do mini quad or 5-inch blades, but if you're doing a photography quad or anything or an airplane, this is exactly the same thing. If it lands like this in the balancer, but always favors one side or the other, that's a hub issue. If it's heavy on one blade or the other, it'll gravitationally pull towards that blade. So let me go ahead and take some off that hub. Probably not a heck of a lot. And it looks like I need to take a touch more off that blade. One thing I do want you guys to consider, if you've never sharpened a boat prop with a Dremel tool before, you might want to do it by hand. Because it does take a little bit of skill there to do, or else you'll fuck it up. I also recommend, if you can, go with a copper or stainless steel prop. Stay away from the beryllium shit if you don't need it. It's just, you know, I know the diehard race boat guys are like, I can't believe you're sharpening it like that. Well, I'm not a diehard race guy. I want it balanced. I don't want as much cavitation. I want it sharp. That's it. I'm not, you know, going for the eighth second here. So let me go ahead and do a little magic on this. We'll be right back. All right, well, I may have to finish doing this one by hand. Look at that shine. Woo-hoo! Because I just tore up my last sanding disc, so hopefully it's in balance. I have not checked it. I tore up the last sanding disc, and that's sharp. Yeah. Yeah, that'll cut you. You can kill some swimmers with that one, guys. Go to Bardwell's pool. All right, so where did my thingamabobber go? It's around here somewhere. There it is. Duh. All right. So, I'm going to put this in. And I did polish it with the wire wheel one last time. And it should be good enough. Yeah. Look at that. Pretty. Okay. Let's see what happens. I'm going to zoom in. A lot better. See where she ends up. Definitely have some good balance now compared to. Now I can tell just by the way it's doing that, this lobe is still a touch heavy, but it's not bad. It's not bad. Definitely got a lot more. That's pretty high RPM, and it's not even shaking. So, I can always tweak it in a little bit later, but it's so minute, guys, that, like I said, we're not racing. That is 99.9% better than it was before. So, after we test it and do all that good shit, we will hand sharpen it a little bit more. But that's good enough for the girls we date at this point. Damn it, idiot. Okay. So, now, let's go get the boat, and let's finalize the drivetrain. And then all we've got left to do is the canopy, and bam, test drive. And the cool part is, I'm going home, back to my home lake, next weekend for Christmas to visit Mom. So we're going to try to do the maiden next weekend. So if the weather holds out, because I got kayaks up there, if something bad happens, and my rescue boat should be done, it's going to be sweet. So anyway, be right back with the boat. Bam, we're back. Okay. So, had to get a roto twister. Bam. Hang on. That's tight. Okay. So, we're going to do the drivetrain at this point. I still haven't finished the canopy latches just yet. That's okay. Ignore those. So, I put this line in just temporary to show you guys. I'm not going to use this. Do not use aquarium tubing. Trust me when I say the shit sucks. Don't use it. Gets hot, collapses, whatever. But in this case, the bottom feed pickup goes into the collar here, through the collar out here, into the inlet of the motor, outlet of the motor to here. But this kink here, that's bad. I ran out of hose. Like I said, the hose isn't going to be here till Tuesday. So I just wanted to show you guys what that looked like. So there we go. Now, we are going to loosen our collet. I'm going to show you what you never, ever, ever fucking do. This is how it came from the factory. Okay, there's our drive dog, all right? The drive dog has a set screw. The drive dog has a set screw in it right here. That's a friction washer. Then you have a bushing inside your stinger. You never, ever run your drive dog flat up against your washer and stinger, ever. You want this to have about a, whatever width of shaft you're running is the gap that you want in here. The reason being, let's pull this out. We'll do a little bit of boat physics here. I don't have the right size wrenches here. That's okay. We'll use a metric adjustable. All right. Because I'm just too lazy to rifle through the toolbox to get the right shit. It's very important to have that. I can't stress enough how important it is to have that gap in the flex shaft, guys. Okay, because what happens, think of a rubber band powered airplane, okay, stretched all the way and then try to wind it, because what happens is these flex shafts are just metal windings, all right? When those metal windings wind up, they shrink, right? They twist, like think of a rubber band. You twist a rubber band and it gets shorter, right? Because you're taking up mass in the helix. The exact same thing. God, this thing is fucking bitchy. The exact same thing happens with a boat shaft. Do not run your boat without a gap or you will have problems. There we go. All right, we'll loosen our collet up. We're going to, hopefully this comes out. Oh, you bitch. Of course. Factory jammed it all the way up, I'm assuming. All right, let me, what I'll do with this, probably take this against the nut, pop it out. Be right back. All right, so we're back. I ended up removing the stinger because this is actually a square shaft drive, which is really not what I'm used to. So we're gonna take this out. This is the shaft, which is really non-impressive, very much non-impressive. So that is a what they call a square shaft. And so that means I have to adjust it via stinger, which kind of sucks. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna grease the living shit out of this thing, then we're gonna seat it in here. Okay. And then, yeah, it's a fixed length. So we're gonna have to adjust the collet on the prop side. So, okay, fair enough. Sorry guys, not used to that. Hang on. I use this stuff, good old fashioned marine grease, for my shafts. I just, that's just me. You can use RC boat shaft grease, you can use whatever, but you want to get it very liberal. Ooh, did I just use that word? On here, okay? Nice and thick. Because this does two things. One, it lubricates it, no shit. And the other thing is it keeps water out of the shaft, which is also known as the stuffing tube. Let me grab a paper towel. What the fuck did I do there? All right, so then we're also going to, I am so not used to this. I will be replacing this stinger and putting it in my old school style shafts. Actually, let me see if I even have one. I might make this mod right now if I can. Hang on. All right, no such luck. I do have a spare shaft, but it will not fit this particular machine. So I will be ordering a new one, and I will show you guys that when it gets here. So, yeah, I don't like having to take my stinger apart just to swap out a shaft or adjust a shaft or to grease a shaft. Normally, what you do with a one-piece system is you will loosen the collet, slide it out. Do everything up, slide it back in. So I need to, and I like that. Is it necessary? Maybe not. But nonetheless, that's what we're going to do. So we're gonna grease this. There we go. Yeah, I'm just old school. If you have one of these boats, you don't have to do it that way, but you also have to remember, you know, they wreck every half hour, 45 minutes of running, you really should re-grease your drive shaft. So, just saying, kids. All right, so square gay side goes on the tube. Okay, right up into here. And all we do then is refit our stinger, lock everything in, and I'll show you how to measure it. Be right back. All right, aside from the rudder, that is screwed back down. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take our collet set screws, and per usual, this is definitely a bit that you want to lock tight, guys, I'm telling you. Really sucks when the shit lets go out at sea. Okay. So, and since these are going into a T-slot, or a slotted shaft, you don't have to torque the shit out of them. If this were a collet that was getting threaded onto a nitro engine, you usually torque the shit out of it, but since these are, make sure we're lined up. Looks like we are. Okay. Yeah, whatever. All right, so we're gonna tighten this back up. I usually do a little bit of Loctite on my collet. I know a lot of guys don't, but I have had them come undone from vibration, and I don't trust this fucking shaft collet as far as I can throw it right now, or the shaft I should say. That's the one I've heard some reviews that they said the shaft sucked in this boat, but my rule is don't replace it till it does. But I'm gonna replace this one anyway because I didn't realize it was that bad. So thread this up. Okay. Again, you don't have to bust your balls tightening this down, but you definitely, one, should use the right wrenches, not big fat ass adjustable wrenches. There we go. But get her nice and tight. Okie dokie, so that's done. Now I'm going to set the prop. So this one's a little bit different. We can go flush against the shaft. And here's why. I was explaining to you how it's like a rubber band, right? Well, that's for a one-piece shaft because you literally have the shaft soldered to the prop shaft, right? It's literally welded, soldered to it. And when that one piece twists up, when you take off out of the water, it's one piece. So it's, you have to have that gap. This is a two-piece, so you've got a drivetrain, and then you've got the shaft. So what's gonna happen is the shaft is gonna curl and just pull in and out a little bit of that square stock in the back. So we don't have to worry about that. So I'm gonna throw the prop on and show you what we got. All right, and we're back. So here we go. The drivetrain is now in, but not adjusted, okay? The prop is on, everything's tightened back up, squared back up, ready to rock and roll. I will adjust the stinger when we're in the water. You usually want your stinger level with the surface level water, and that's very, very hard to do with a boat on dry land because you don't know your angles or anything like that. Deeper is slower. You know, if you go down vertical, it's gonna give you a slower, but you're gonna have much more control and steering. Higher up to the surface you are, you'll be faster, less resistance, less mass, but you will not have as good a control, and your chances of cavitating are a little bit greater, obviously. But as far as the angle of the stinger this way, you want this ideally to be sent parallel with the surface of the water, okay? We'll go over setups when we actually run the boat later on in life. But now what we're going to do, we're gonna dress the hull, the bottom, and then we're done. So hang on 2 seconds. All right, I have the hull, the boat, upside down. God, I gotta clean this garage up. And I will try to get this in view. Now, there's a very big misunderstanding. I gotta wire wheel this, that's pretty gross. There's a big misunderstanding that, you know, oh, I'm gonna wax the bottom of my hull, it's gonna make it faster. That is not true, believe it or not. Hang on. you want it rough. You want to take 220, 320, 300 grit sandpaper and sand along the travel of the water. The reason being is what is surface tension and displacement. Okay, or mass area. So when you've got a huge flat area, you've got a lot more surface tension. Okay, when you've got less surface area, which would be jagged, because the water, the theory is this. Let's explain this a little easier. The theory is that these little dips in the fiberglass in the hull will actually trap water, which they will, believe it or not. So when those trap water, 3/4 of your hull is no longer touching the water. Does that make sense? So it's less surface area, which makes a faster hull. Just waxing or putting fucking Minwax or whatever people do, thinking that they're gonna make their hulls fast, that is not the case. Now, is it a huge amount of speed you're gonna gain? No, but you're gonna get better, a little bit better control and a little bit more top end. It's just better to do. So you really only have to do the riding surfaces. So I'm actually going to sand from like right here back. Let me find some Pippa. I don't have any actual sheet paper. I only have a disc. So we're going to use 220. And we're going to go from this line right here. And we're not doing a ton. What you want to do is basically just take the shine off. That's all you're doing. Sorry, smoking hot wife. So, all you're doing is just taking the shine off the hull. That we're gonna, a little bit of goop there. Okay. And you want all those lines to go in the direction of travel. I'm not doing up by the bow. Yeah, look at that. That's a good thing, okay? Now we're gonna do up here. I'm not doing the inside. The inside of the cat is not a travel area, okay? It's only the outer sponsons like this. Now, again, is this going to make you go Mach 8 versus Mach 7? Nah. But there is scientific, I mean, it's physics. You have less surface area when you trap air. Now, we're talking very, very minute. But this is what all the race guys do. They, none of them run shiny hulls. Shiny hulls are slow hulls. It's just a fact. Okay, and we're not really taking off any material. I mean, we are, but nothing to worry about. Then I will take just a Clorox wipe, just so your lady doesn't yell at you when you bring it in the house. And we'll get the dust off. But you don't have to. You can skip this step. I gotta get the gunk out of that. But we're gonna put new tubing in there, so I'll clean that out when I do. All right. And that is it. Aside from setup, that's the whole boat. So I am going to cut it here. Hopefully this weekend we're going to have our maiden. But I'm going to throw up another video, hopefully later tonight, might be tomorrow. There's going to be a video just of pictures of the boat, just so you guys can really see how she turned out. So until next time, kids, bam, keep shining side up.